Let us start our discussions. Right. So last week, during our interactions, there were some doubts related to how do we design our own websites. So during the discussion, I mentioned about what are the things that are required to build a website. Things in the sense, the software tools and the software technologies that required for your designing and developing a website. So I have given a brief introduction in the last week. You can see that video also, that video link is being provided on the Moodle server. So in continuation to that one, today we will see how to design and develop a user interface, rather a web pages for our websites, with starting with the user login pages. So let me just brief you here. In order to design and develop web applications, what you require is you need something which are related to the user, in the sense that the front-end technologies, and something which are related to the servers and the communication systems, which are basically related to the back-end. So in the front-end, you will be seeing a web page where a user interacts with the web pages. So user is going to give some inputs, as well as user is going to click some buttons, or maybe it can be text, or it can be voice, or it can be video. So a user is giving some inputs using a web page, and those inputs from that web page through the browser application, the request goes to the server. So basically that model where you are entering the data from your computer or from your site, that data is given, passed on to the server or forwarded to the server for processing the data. So that's the this is a pictorial representation. That is a big picture about website application, how the things goes on in the front end and how the things goes on in the back end. So in the back end, you have several servers. So those servers, basically they do some kind of data processing for which the data has come from the users. So basically those servers have been, now we can have something called as a database server, followed by a web server and a programming language, a tool or a parser which tries to interact with your database and the web server. Of course, this is the not only the servers that you find in the backend servers, but for a beginner to understand, we always start with this basic stuff, so that the beginner in the sense the web developer tries to understand what are all the things that are required to make sure that the website or the web application is been fruitfully working and it is properly maintained. So here you know the purpose of a database server. Usually the database server's duty is to store the data and provide the data for which the data is being requested from the user. Similarly, a web server is basically try to process the requests that are being given from the user, and those requests that are getting processed will be taken care of by this particular web server. And you have a programming language. So the programming language is basically helps us to interact various other software tools and with the user for better productivity. So here, this programming language, what we are using in our framework, in our stack of software tools, we use called as PHP. So PHP is basically a hypertext preprocessor. And the web server that we are trying to understand in the beginning stage is basically your Apache web server. And the database server that we are going to use it for our storing and passing on the request or forwarding the request for various clients and users, we use the MySQL server here. So on the front end, of course, you might have by this time might have understood about what is the purpose of a JavaScript. So this JavaScript helps us to make a proper understanding of what the user requirements are, the user interactivity features, and all those things are being carried on with your JavaScripts. So JavaScript will take care of the user interactivity very well at the client side. So anything that data is getting processed means data is getting processed with the help of your JavaScript. that is at the client side, that's basically at the browser side. So these are the tools that we need to make sure you try to understand. So whenever you are trying to make some website developments or website managements, usually the most known stacks is a collection of software tools. So usually in the web technologies, in internet technologies, we use the term stack to make you to understand that. And there are a combination of several tools which will help us to facilitate in the development of the website and other software tools to be properly managed. So here there are available stacks in our market. What are the things? That is LAMP. So the L stands for Linux operating system. You have a WAMP, which basically W stands for Windows, and you have a MAMP. MAMP in that M stands for your Mac, and you have XAMPP, where X stands for cross-platform for distributing the code to be run across in these three platforms easily. So here, A stands for your web server Apache, M stands for MySQL, and P stands for PHP. Whereas in this XAMPP, the extra P is basically for Perl. Perl is another programming language, basically a server-side scripting language. For various web services, we also make use of this particular software. So not to make more confusion for you all, just understand that these are the softwares. So nowadays, all the softwares are bundled together. In the olden days, they have been separately, you need to configure it. But nowadays, they have been bundled together. So how do we install it and how do we proceed, that I have given in the my videos. So this is the installation of LAMP stack. Just follow this very simple 6 steps on your Linux operating system of your LAMP, means of your Ubuntu or your Linux or any Linux, a Unix flavor operating system. So more or less the steps remains the same. So once you install your LAMP stack, you can check whether your PHP is installed or not by giving the PHP space small hyphen small v version. Then similarly MySQL, check the MySQL, and similarly check for your Apache web server by typing the local host whether they are running on your computer or not. So the basic introduction to PHP I have given in my slides, how to write the PHP program, how do you use the various syntaxes, functions and all. Please go through that one. For today, for this session, so anyway, I'm going to give some of those PHP details also in this session. Let me give you some, this is a small demo on how do you design and develop your websites. Usually most of the time, your websites always will start with something called user login. User login page will be there. Whenever your user authentication is successful, then only you'll be able to log in into their websites and do according to your respective activities. So let us now go for how do you design and develop your user login system. So in this process, definitely I'm going through the features of PHP. Even those who are new also, do not worry. I'm going to reiterate some of those things. Similarly for MySQL also, the basic important information that you require for this course especially. So regarding the MySQL also, I'm going to give some of the details here. So in continuation to what you have done, this PPT and this video recording is there on the PHP course material of your Moodle site. Please go through it. Right. So now let us start by writing a simple program of a user interface for a login page. So once you install, your LAMP stack on your Unix operating system, please look for your things like what I said, PHP, if it is installed in a system or not, small hyphen. So if it is not visible, let me just maximize the screen for you again. Just hold on for a second. Hope you know you are able to see the commands. So I'm on the right side of my screen. I'm using my Oracle VirtualBox where my Ubuntu is installed. On the Ubuntu, again, I installed the LAMP. So the installation steps are there available in the videos. Please go through it. Now let us Once the PHP is now installed, yes, you can check for MySQL also. You can type MySQL space. Of course, all these steps are not that much required for your VAM, but people who are practicing on Linux, let me go through it. So the next, on coming Friday, I will show you the steps on the VAM server, Windows platform. But today you need to understand about the Linux system, then we'll go for the LAMP in the next session. So here, I'm just checking for the MySQL. Yes, once the MySQL is successfully installed on your system, you usually get the prompt like this, MySQL greater than symbol. That implies that the MySQL is installed on your system. I'll come back to this in the later stage. Yes, I'm making sure the system is working properly. And this is one browser called Hilo, a lightweight browser. Of course, this is also similar to your Mozilla, Google Chrome, your Internet Explorer, whatever thing you can, whichever is comfortable for you, you can use those browsers on your system. It's not compulsory that you need to use only Dilo. This is just, I have installed a server version on my VirtualBox, so I'm using this Dilo. The name of the browser is Dilo. This is basically a web browser. I'm just checking whether my Apache is also running here or not by entering the URL, localhost. Okay, so my Apache, PHP, and MySQL 3 are running for me. So now let us write the programs for your login system. In order to write the program for your login system, what your login page usually looks like, your login page usually consists of two text boxes, one for your username, another for your password, and two or three buttons. Among them, one button will be your login button. The next button will be reset button or something like that, right? Now to design your web page, so I'm taking the help of your HTML in this session. You know what are the HTML commands you need to go. So before I proceed, please make sure that always your document files are going to be stored at a particular folder. So here I am going to store my all my web pages under a folder called where www-html. So in this, I'm going to create a directory so that this is something like my site one. This is my website one. I'm creating a website one so that all the documents and web pages related to this my site one will be stored under this particular folder. Same directory to my site one. So right now it is empty, nothing is there. So you can use an editor, any editor, Notepad or your Visual Studio Code editor or whatever it may be, whichever is suitable for you. And use an editor. I'm using the, since I'm using Linux, I'm using the Visual Editor here. So here, VI editor and something like login.html. So you know how to enter the program into the VI editors. So here I'm starting entering the commands. Those commands are basically your HTML commands. So in the body tag, what I try to do is I'm going to create a form. So you know what is a form is? A form tag, which you might have already done some practice by this time. A form tag will enable you to have some user controls, user components onto your form tag. So what are the things that you require for your form tag? Things means the attributes. So you'll you need to have a name, something like form name is F1. Name is another attribute. Then you have action. What happens when a user clicks a button on this particular form? So what the form should do? So an attribute of the action type, then something like if you are having a button on submit. So the on submit button should do something for you. Similarly, you might have seen what a JavaScript is going to do for that one. So on submit button, then something like, yes. And the method that I have told you when I'm filling the user registration form. So the method which I'm using here is basically your post method. You know what is the difference between post and the get method? So the post method is used to send the data to another web page. That web page which you are going to specify it in the action attribute. So here, when a user clicks this login page, once the login is successful or something to be done, or some means once the user enters the data, what needs to be done the next step? So that next step is given in a particular page called authentication.php. So .php means a file which is going to run on the server. So once the user enters some data on the web page, that data which has been sent to the server, on the server, this authentication.php page is going to do some processing. It is going to work for you. The server, on the server, this page is going to be executed for you. And before that data is being posted onto the server, I need to perform some validation checks on my web page. So that is user validation checks, something like the user has entered correct form of username and the correct form of the password or not. That kind of checks you can perform it at the client side itself. So that checks you can say something like this. Yeah, people are still coming. So I'm going to run a method called validation. That is a validation method. It's always meant for checking whether the user has entered the user credentials. Credentials in the sense username and the password in the form that you require him to enter. As a web developer, you might have provided certain features. So if you want more details on user validation, in my JavaScript video classes, you may see what is user validation is all about. So this is what the form tag, the attributes. So there will be a corresponding closing form tag. So this is what the opening form tag and the closing form tag. So what this form tag contains, basically your form tag contains some user controls, user components, or user elements where user is going to interact with, like your text boxes, buttons, your videos or images. So whatever anchor links, whatever it may be. So some elements of your web pages will be present in between your form tags. So here, once you give this form attribute, right. Now, let me just let us see, username is basically a label. So here, you can put that label in a paragraph. So one, in the paragraph tag itself, I'm giving a label. So label, followed by, you need to put the input type is equal to text. And you need to give some ID to this input button, the text button, something like the user name or something, whatever it may be. And the name can also be the same. Not to have some confusion. So this is so you have something here. Basically, you can, yeah, the closing tag for this is remain. So you need not specify the closing tag explicitly. You can just as well mention the end of your input tag. It implies it is going to be closed here. Or you can use a specific thing there. Right. Similarly, you can put another. This is basically your password. And again, password, input type, the type which the user is going to give is also a text. If you want to hide the characters what the user is giving, you can give this type as password. For time being, I'm giving this is itself is your text. Yes, you have given two labels, two text boxes, and let us give one more button here, just a button. You can go and put and the text that is to be seen on that button is the value that is login. If you don't want to give button on submit, so if you give the submit itself, because already given on submit here the function, so you can directly give it is a submit type. So this is the closing of this paragraph. So you have on your form, you have put some three controls, of course, two text boxes and one button. So this is what your end of your form tag. And that is what your end of your, of course, the body tag. So now, let us see how this particular program runs on our localhost. So not to just save this particular program. Of course, you have not written the validation here. Of course, I told you, and you have not written the another page where once you click the button, it should go to the authentication.php. Authentication has to be done at the server side, that the user has entered the correct credentials or not. That's the checking of the server. That's the duty of the server. So once you save the file, login.html. So now you go to your localhost, then you go to your the folder name, that is my site wine. My site, under that particular folder, you have given something called login, or you can, if you don't know, you can just enter, you can see your whatever your files are there. So you have given login.html. If you know the file name, you can just select the file name. So now your user interface, that is what, of course, I have not given. If you want to make a little bit more attractive, you can put your CSS here properly. Right, let me just put at least one heading. So I just put one heading here and I will try to reload the page. Now you see this is a login page. You can design according to your requirements. So for you to understand, just I've taken a small example. Now see, as of now, it will take some characters. Just it will take some characters. But when you press enter login, Of course. So now you see when you press the login, what happens? The navigation, if you see on the URL, it has went to the authentication.php. Why it has went to authentication.php? The important reason here is that this goes because you have written in your form attribute. See here in the form attribute, the action part. The action part is the action will tell you to go to the which particular page. So that is authentication.php. But as of now, it is not there because you have not written any code which is there, code to be executed, which has to be there on your server. So before I send it to your server page, let me do some more validation here. Means I need to do some more work here. So you have written one function called here. So on submit, what needs to be done? Validation has to be performed. So you need to write a validation function. So that function can be written always with your JavaScript. So here, before the end of your body tag, you can provide the script. Your JavaScript is going to be there. So how to write functions in your JavaScript is the one which you have written, which you have seen in the classes, I mean the video class, of course. So under the script tag, between your script tags, you write a function here. Of course, the script type is basically your JavaScript. It implies that you are following a JavaScript by default here. We not explicitly mention. Anyway, now coming to what you need to write, a function. What is the name of the function? Validation function. Of course, there are no arguments here. So you are writing a validation function. What that validation function should do? The validation function should check whether the username is entered or not. If it is a blank, you need to alert the user that is a blank for you to understand here. You can put more conditions depending on your requirements. Similarly, the password should also have some value. It should not be blank. If both of them are blank, again, this should be prompted to the user that these things are to be entered. If any, you can put some constraints also. Password can have a certain length, certain number of characters. You know what are the criteria to be followed. You might have seen so many websites as of till now. So those conditions you can also keep here. Similarly for username also. First, for you to understand, just I'm keeping writing a function which says that the username and the password not be blank. So you need to tell that, or you need to inform your browser to check the condition. That is your validation, the form validation, the form components validation. You need to first collect that particular values which are entered on your text boxes. So let it be your user ID. ID is equal to, so how to collect the value? What is the name of this particular text box here? The user text box name is user. Similarly, the button is also having BTN, the ID, whereas for the password text box is pass. So how do you access those values here? You can use the document object that you have seen in the document dot. So how do you collect the value? So first, what is the hierarchy to be followed here? So these controls are present. These controls means the text boxes and the buttons are present under the control, or they're under the container of F1. So document, the web page document has got a form one document, that is F1 document dot. So you can have each particular set of values. So the ID is referring to the user dot value. You can put the function value, or you can just mention that in the hierarchical text. Then where, similarly, you can get the password is equal to document dot F1 dot EA. SS dot VAL value. Yes, you are collecting the text box values into your temporary variables ID and PS. Now you can put the condition something like this. If your the ID dot, you can use the string functions, length is null, or your end, whatever it may be, you can use logical end, logical or, whatever it may be, and your password dot length is equal to null. Yes, if they are null, what needs to be done? You need to write the alert function. Alert is, you know what is an alert? You might have seen our video classes. So both are in here, right? Something like you can write the appropriate statement. Both are null. Both means here. Username and password are null, followed by semicolon. Then what is that you are returning? The function should return a false. Only if it is true, then the correct attribute on return, that is your return true value, is going to be executed here. So this is what your if statement is going to have. Else what needs to be done? You can put more conditions depending on your requirements. If ID dot length or password dot length is not 8 characters sufficient, you can put more conditions here. It all depends on you. So you keep more the conditions, it goes on. So you can have form. Of course, I'm not giving here. I'm leaving this. You can continue with this and put more conditions according to your requirements. So once you have done this one, your form function is done. Your script function is done. So this is what, of course, this validation, please remember this validation is happening at the client side only. This data processing, the data checking, whether the lens, those particular values are not null or not, is being checked at the browser side. It is not sent to the server side. Still, you are checking this happening through your JavaScript. JavaScript is running on the client side itself. Please do remember this. I'm emphasizing on this because some of the beginners who are not been aware, it will be difficult for you to understand. So that's why. Think, let me go by step here. So this is what on submit button return validation. Let us check whether the validation is working or not. So even in the assignment 3, there is a 2-3 questions are there on this validation I have given. If you look closely to the assignments, you need to understand this one. So let me just save this file. Yes, I have saved it. Then again, let me close this and open the browser. My browser is here, right? So localhost and followed by my site one. Yes, the first page is login. My web, that's what is still going here. Let me just check the authentication here for a moment. I think somewhere I made a mistake here.
Nagender, length is equal to 0. String length.
Can be null also, sir.
Null also works here. Okay.
Sir, you should put triple equal to.
Triple equal to. No. Triple equal to. This is equal to operator. It's not a message. Triple equal to. No. Condition only it is failing here. Let me check one by one. Again, I need to debug here. That's the only thing. Okay, let us not. I will check it out. Okay, anyway, I'll check it. Let us just keep hold on this one validation. I'll come back to this. Let us not waste the other things here. So one, of course, this is to be completed. We'll come back to this in the later stage. So now the important things is assume that for time being, assume that the checking is taking place. So let us go ahead. Then I'll check the come back. Let us not waste time. Let us go for the assume that it is acceptable. The conditions are there. Now let us do it on the server side. So when you are writing programming on the server side, so please do remember that two important things on the server side are your basically your these three important things comes into picture is your database, that is what your database, and your the PHP or the web server program. So now let us look for the MySQL database. So once you have installed your MySQL, assume that the client side is ready, perfectly correct. Now coming to the server side, so make sure that your MySQL is running perfectly. Right, so once your MySQL is running perfectly, so this is your database. So what we need to do is we need to provide your data storage capabilities on this database server. Means data storage capabilities means you need to provide some kind of tables. In simple terms, the databases that are required for your web resources to be acceptable. So if you see here, the basic commands for the MySQL, we use something like very simple commands, show databases. Assume that if you are not aware of this one, I'm just giving some basic commands because I'm assuming that you are studying a database course. You will study in depth about the MySQL. So for we require a little bit of information only here in this particular internet technologies about how do we make use of the databases. But designing of your databases, the fundamentals, the principles that you need to follow for your RDBMS, relational database management systems, how do you manage, how do you do some operations on those databases and all, you will study in depth and the breadth in your course, the database management system. For time being, you need not require all that stuff until unless you are very much concerned for that. So what I'm going to show you some basic commands. It will be mostly useful for you to get on with our understanding of our web developments. So now you can use something like show databases. You can see what are the existing show databases here. The existing databases that are there on the server, MySQL server. These are something. So So if you want to create a new database, create database, you can write down those commands, database, the name of the database, something like MySite1. The name of the database is also MySite1, is the database name. Database is a collection of data, collection of tables, collection of users, collection of different objects, collection of different triggers, procedures, methods. All those will be there in this particular MySite1. That is your database I'm creating here. So create database, simply the name of the database you can give, appropriate name which you like to remember and use it for most of your website activities. So once you created, you can see now show databases. Now you see MySite1 is also been created. Of course, it will be empty in this database at this present, at this time. You can use the command use MySite1. It implies that you are going to now consider the MySite1 database. So now the database is changed to your required database, MySite1. So now if you see inside, now you are inside your database. You see, if you like to see what are the tables inside this, as of now, nothing, no table is there. Table is basically your entity, the entity which is related to your objects, information, like your users and other resources that are you using on your websites can be stored in the form of tables, and the collection of tables will be under the category of MySite1. So collection of not only tables or users, all other different set of objects that are related to MySite1, all can be stored here. So now let us see how to create a tables. You can use the create command, which is basically your DDL, data definition language command. What is DDL, what is DML, what is DCL and all, you will study mostly in your database course. So for time being, just create. It means you're creating a new entity. So that entity is basically your table. So the name of the table is something like users. So I'm creating a table, users. This table has got different attributes or different columns. You can call it as attributes, you can call it as columns, you can call it as field names. Something like username is one particular column. Username, because once a user enters his username and password, those two things has to be transferred and stored in this particular table of this database. So username is of what data type? MySQL requires, it is a strongly type, we require the data type for this one. So MySQL provides a data type called varchar, variable character. Variable character, it's the alphanumeric values can be stored here, alphabets as well as numbers. It also supports integers, it also supports characters. So you'll study more clearly what are the data types the MySQL provides. That information you'll get it from your database management system course. But remember, at this moment, we are using one data type called as variable character data type. You need to specify the size also. So that is one column. And the other column is something like password, which is also, I'm giving it as varchar of size 10 characters, something like that. So then followed by semicolon. So that's why you are going to create a table called users. If you want to see the structure of this, you can use a command called describe users. So here you can see this is the username, the field name. There are two fields, username and password. Their type is varchar. And you can put some constraints to this field names, like it cannot be null. Definitely there should be a value, and that value should be unique value. And that is a key value and all. So these principles you'll study more closely in your database course. At present, you need not worry about all those things. More specifically, scientifically, how do you all go about? We'll go step by step. So for time being, just I'm giving you the steps to create a database. Under one database, you're creating one table. The name of the table is users. There, this users table will store all the usernames and the corresponding password. For time being, without any constraints, you have created this table here. Means there is no integrity constraints, referential constraints are not there at this moment. So now, how do we insert data into this table? You have another DML command you can use called insert into the table name users, the values. These are the statements. These are called SQL statements. Insert into the table name values, create table. These are all called SQL statements or SQL statements, structured query language. What are the structured query language? The more details, you'll get it in your course, of course. So this is one syntax to create a username, syntax to enter some values. So you are entering the values into this users table now. So since you said it is a var char, it's a variable character, alphanumeric values can be entered here, which is of size, maximum size is 10, which you are given here. Something like ABC. Of course, this will be the username, and I'm giving something like ABC123. Of course, later you can encrypt all these things. For a beginner, you can make it understand, I'm giving so. One row is inserted. Now to see what is present in this table, you have another SQL statement called select, followed by the attribute names from a particular table. From the users table, I'm seeing now. Now you can see what is present in the users table. The username is ABC, the password is ABC123. You can clearly see what is present in the table here. Let me insert one more here, something like NKS and NKS123. One more row is inserted. You can insert, keep on inserting, so row by row, or you want to insert it. Bulk data also can be inserted here. So now you can see there are two users, ABC and KS, ABC and the corresponding passwords you have entered here. So that's it. This is what just required for you to interact with your database from your PHP now. So let us see now how this goes on here. So here, let us go for writing the program to connect to this data from the database should be connected to your PHP. How do you connect the database to your PHP? So you need to connect the database to the PHP. You can come out of this database. So whenever you do the local database operations, you can directly go to the MySQL prompt and you can use the DML, DCL, DDL, other sets of commands. But for timing, once you created your database and your table is created, the name and the corresponding field names have been created with some values, dummy values. These are all dummy values for you to understand. Come out of this MySQL database server, or come on to your my site folder where you are going to store your scripting files. So at this point, you try to now, if you see here, at this we have only login.html. This is basically a login.html page which has been shown to the user. So let us write some scripts which are related to the server-side processing. So basically, you are going to write .php files. Those data which need to be processed from the server side. So here, I'm using something like to interact with your PHP, you need to have something like connection.php. I'm writing a PHP file to connect to your database. So you can use something like your PHP script always starts with less than symbol, question mark, followed by PHP. This is the open tag for your PHP. So, and the closing tag for PHP is your question mark, followed by your greater than symbol. So anything you write between these two are your PHP statements that are going to be executed on your server. So these things, now let us write the PHP statements. So here, in PHP, always your variables are being prefixed with your dollar symbol. I'm using a variable name called host, and the server name is basically your the local host, the server. So if you are given a domain name like your scislearn1.uhd.ac.in, they can give that corresponding host name, the latest name. But now our server name is localhost, which is running on my local computer itself. So then you need to specify the user who is going to use this particular localhost system. So if you see my login, this is the person who is logging into my, this is the person. So you can specify the name here, name of the user who is logged in to that computer. This is username fog1 I created in my Unix operating system. Then you need to provide another important information, something like the user, and you need to provide the password for that, password of the user who is going to log in. If you created a password for that, you just remember that password and you specify the password in the password variable. Then which database are you going to refer to? The name of the database. So the name of the database is something like my site one is the name of the database which I'm referring. So of course I am just giving these variable values. These values has to be specified in a function called mysqli underscore connect. There is a MySQL method name called as mysqli connect. This is a built-in method name. So this built-in method name takes arguments of these variables, host followed by your with the user followed by your the password of that user and the database name. Right. So this function is the most important function, which is basically trying to connect your PHP parser onto the database which you are trying to use it in your program. So that if it is connected, you can use a variable called dot con, a connection which is going to be established. If there is any problem in connecting to this statement or to this database, if there is a problem, means either at the whatever the user credentials the user is going to connect, or your MySite one is not present or something like this, if unable to connect to your databases, you also should make it to understand that there is a problem with your connections. So if mysqli underscore connect is having certain errors, so then what you need to do, you say there are some echo statement unable to database, and you need to exit, of course. So this all you just make some connection statement. The connection statement is basically, this is the important, the only one statement. You can avoid these variables also if you can directly specify the values into this arguments. This is very simple program to have a connection. Always it will be better to have those connections here. So let's save this program. So your connection.php is done here. Now let us go for the actual authentication dot.
Sir, you missed the round bracket there.
Sorry.
Rounded bracket. You missed the rounded bracket in the file. In MySQL, I connect error number.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, the closing bracket of the if statement. Thank you. Let us, this is a connection statement. Now let us go for the actual code that is to be processed at the server side. Authentication dot php, that is the name which you are given in your HTML file. Once the user enters this one, this is authentication dot php. So what this is also a PHP file. Always your PHP tags will start with the opening tab. So it implies that these tags, either if you go for ASP.NET, those people are aware of ASP.NET, will be percentage symbol here. Now you're using PHP, you can use the long form question mark followed by PHP. Sometimes some of the PHP parsers do permit not to have this PHP also. Just a less than symbol followed by question mark, it implies that it belongs to PHP. So this PHP, you are going to write your data processing that needs to come here. So the first step is to collect the box values into this PHP file. The box values means the username and the password. Whatever the user has entered into that boxes, that box values has to be coming to this file. So the file is going to be activated on the server side. But once the file is activated, you need to collect the values. So to have that values to be collected, which is to be coming from a global reference variable. So always in PHP, the global reference variable starts with dollar. So you can use the dollar and you can use the post method or get method. So obviously the post method implies that the values are going to be securely invisible to the user when the data is coming from the one page to another page. That is from your login.html, your data is coming to authentication.php page. So when the login.html is sending the username and passwords, you can see those if you are using the get method, you can see the values what the exactly user is entering. So that is always possible for the hacker to see that one. That's why the get method mostly people will not prefer to use. So you better go for the post method. So what is the post method? You need to specify that particular variable that is coming from that particular login page. So if you remember, you can open that particular page on another window and you can see that. So if you see, this is the name, user is the name, and pass is the particular IDs you have been given here. So you specify those names correctly here. This is user. Similarly, you are getting that particular $_post. Remember, PHP is a case sensitive, so you need to be very careful with respect to the capital letters and the small letters. So you are getting these values into this page. This page is basically your authentication.php. But once you get these values, you better store it in your temporary variables. So how do you store it into your temporary variables? You can use your own temporary variables, user name. So your username holds that particular value which is coming from your login page. So you are getting that values using the $_post method. So once you obtain these values, so you are now username. If you know if whether you are getting those values correctly or not, you can use your echo statement or your print statement. So you can use echo $username. It will print what this particular variable contains when this particular page has been landed here, when the server gets onto this particular page. You can as well see whether your values are correctly passed onto the next page or not. So let me just execute and see. Let us see whether you are getting the username and password correctly or not. So you are going to go to again your login page here. So you are not getting this particular authentication values here. It means, let us see, try to debug this one. You need not have the connection, of course, authentication. The values are not coming to this particular page, so there is some mistake here. Let me just find out that mistake.
Nagendra, return true in general case in the validation at the end. Yeah, just return true there. Just one more thing. I mean, like, please change the ph.length to 0. I want to see that.
Let me just put this as comments, or at least what I mean.
Okay. Completely. You are removing the script. Okay. Right. Mm-hmm. HTML comment. Nagendra. The script is in the body now.
Uh, Sorry, sir, I did not get you.
Now you are in the HTML, so the is like
sorry.
Less than. Even that one will work. Within the script, you have to do.
The form attributes, somehow it is wrong, sir. The form attributes on the anyway, this I will check it out. So something is missing here. Maybe I missed something. Okay, anyway, I'll just not waste time here. So I'll just correct it and I'll anyway upload it onto the website. Let me just check after the session is over. So the process, anyway, you need to understand the process here. So this authentication page, basically you are going to write the user details that have been entered from the web page of this login.html. What are the username and password the user enters here? So that needs to be verified. So this page, you need to write a code. Let me just give maybe some the basic code. We can write it here, then later we can correct it here. So let us write that code to maximum extent and then we'll correct it later. So assuming that that particular code is coming to this particular web page, this is another, of course, another assumption. Sorry for that. So anyway, we'll see. So this particular value which Hold on. Yeah, now you see that's just a syntactical mirror. Now you are able to get that values here. Whatever you entered here, you are getting onto the authentication.php. So I just recollect here. So that mistake is nothing but the brackets. So the brackets here, it is not a function, there's an array, $post array. So you are getting the user and the password. These two corresponding variable values you are getting from your login.php to this particular login.html to your authentication.php. So once you receive those values, and those values are temporarily hold on to your username and password, so now you can manipulate in the sense that you can process that particular data. So you can remove those echo statements. So now, how do you process that data? So you can say that that particular data, something like you can write the $SQL statements you can write here. So the SQL statement, the various database query statements, these are called your query statements, like what you have done there. you can write something like you are select the select star from the users table. So in order to use this one, you need to make sure that you include your what is it, connection.php. Yeah, connection.php. So this is a database connection string is available in this particular file. You are including that particular file like a library file, so that that dot dollar con which you have used in this connection.php, the dollar con consists of your connection statement that is established to your database. So select start from users. So you can write that particular statement here using the conditions, like you can use the where clause. So the where statement is something like the database field name, the username is equal to which this particular dollar username. So since you are using in the double quotes, please make sure that you are going to get the internal value here. This is your dollar, the PHP variable dollar username, and the database field name. What is the database field name you have used? If you cannot recollect that particular database field name, you can as well go to your MySQL. Oh, sorry. Use my site one.
Sir, please increase the font size, sir.
Is it okay now? I have zoomed in. Well, you need. Yeah, is it okay now?
Yes, sir. It's okay.
So here you can see this username and password. These are the two field names you are given in your database table. So those two names only you have to give it here. One is your username, all in small case letters. Username, yes, username is this particular database field name, and the other field name is your password, password. So PSS, and you can give this particular password is equal to your the password which is coming from the login.html file which you have stored temporarily on your variable dollar.
Sir, in this table also increase the font size, sir. It's two. It's okay, sir.
Because this is a virtual machine, the screen, even somebody wants to come in, here, I need to allow. So that's why I just kept this small screen here. Otherwise, you can just go, you can close this one and as well go with this viewing into a complete screen mode, scaled mode. Now you can see this complete screen. So here you have entered this statement, select star from users where username is equal to the name, password. Let me just send this to the screen. Put here the quotes, password. So this is the statement. You can keep whatever the user has entered into that boxes. That particular value you are getting it here. So that particular statement is nothing but your SQL statement that you prepared. This is called a prepared statement in MySQL. So this is a prepared statement. You are preparing the statement into this particular variable. So that variable is SQL, and basically this is a variable of PHP. So you are using a dollar SQL. what you need to do with this prepared statement. This statement needs to be this prepared variable statement. You are going to the next state, next line. So here you are using that particular result is equal to, you can use another variable and you use the command here. The command is basically mysqli underscore that query, the statement what you prepared. So that query is the function name which needs to be executed here with respect to the connection should be established and that statement has to be executed. So these are the two, this is one statement which is your database statement, and this is the MySQL method, the function which tries to establish the connection that you already done in your connection.php. If you remember, $con is equal to MySQL underscore connect statement will be there, which you pass the arguments, your database name, the user password, and the localhost parameter values, followed by your this prepared statement has to be executed. Once this method executes, it will return a value, either true or false, where it is executed. The database is connected, and this this particular statement, what you are given, the DML statement is executed. If everything is executed, you will get the result. So that result, you are going to store it in your temporary variable of your PHP, that is $res. So the $res contains your values here. So that you need to collect that $res value and make sure that that are going to be collecting. If there are multiple rows or single rows or whatever it may be, you can go with that. So let me just collect into a particular row value. Of each single value, each single instance of your particular row has to be collected. That is what the connection statement does it. So you can fetch that particular MySQLi, fetch that particular row. Fetching means retrieving the row, retrieving the record from that particular table. So there's a fetch command is going to be used. That value is going to be stored in the form of an array, and that is based on your the result that is successfully obtained from the prepared statement. So it requires this particular MySQL fetch array requires another argument. Basically, you need to associate these values. So you have something called MySQLi underscore ASSOC. Associate this particular result with this corresponding row. A built-in a keyword, built-in command. That is a rule that we are going to follow for the MySQL fetch array. So once that is done, so your up to your results have been obtained. You can see how many such rows are there, because this is basically a username and a password. Only one user with respect to that one password only, you'll get only one row here. But later when you fetch like number of employees, number of customers, number of students and all, you'll have several values of this row. So this row array contains row of 0, row of 1, row of 2, row of 3. Like this, you will have a different set of rows that you can put it in a loop and display all the records of that particular table. That's your logic you need to understand. So that is what we'll see in some other examples. But at present, you will store this value. You can put it in a count is equal to get the number of rows. MySQL, always all functions starts with MySQL only. Here we have something called num rows, number of rows for that particular dollar row. So the dollar row, or you can say result. Yes. So you can put a condition if dollar count is equal to one. If one, only one row is present, obviously one user with one password is going to be there. Then again, you can put something like echo login successful, and you can redirect to another page. So in order to redirect to another page, you can use a function called header. Header followed by the location with the URL that I have shown you in the that my presentation. So you can go through each one. If there is some problem here, if it is not done, then you can say something like else. You can say login not successful. Okay, not successful. What are the statements you like to have? And you can redirect to login page again, because at present you will be in authentication. You have to provide the user to go to your login page. So to go to the login page, you can use that same header method with the location values. You can specify those things. So assume that I'm just let me complete this particular thing. So let's complete this. So these are the statement. That's it. That is the only thing we need to understand here with a small PHP MySQL problem. This is basically your authentication. Once you save your program, don't confuse, there are two screens here. One screen is this, another screen is this. Let me come out of this database, exit. So these are the two screens which you can, should not confuse here. This is one and this is another. And this is your the actual web page. So let me reload this one. Yes. Login ABC. Because here I have not put the password attribute here. Still there is another error here somewhere. Values are not coming in here.
Sir, in the SQL command, there should be a double quote at the end, closing one.
Oh, sorry, I forgot it. So that is there in the authentication page. Just one second. Yeah. So I started this here. Yeah, sorry. Oh, right. This one error. Sometimes, yes, when you directly write the course, these are all the things. I need to go through it again. Yes, now let me just save this one. Back to your web browser. Well, some more errors are there here. So in order to debug this one, the best way is to go line by line, check it. So let us put the echo statements. Always echo statements will be useful for us to check up to that statement if the things are working fine or not. So that's why usually this echo statement is equivalent to your print statement of your C programming language. So let me just check whether first thing is whether I'm able to get those values here. So once you get those values here, then these statements, the MySQL statements are working fine or not. Let us check. So this is how you need to debug your programs. Oops, now it is successful. Oh, I just refreshed that one. So I'm now able to get those values also here. So let me just type some other values and see. Login not successful. Very good. So this is how you are going to check sending the data and connecting to your database and retrieving the values. Of course, I have just that validation on the client side is missing. Maybe that I will check it and post it. Otherwise, more or less the program is done. So you like this, you need to create your web pages. So next class, I will tell you how to create your student login pages. And of course, registration also I have done directly on the database, inserting the values here. username, the ABC, and in case I've directly inserted the statements, you can write a web page to have a user registration to enter the values. Only thing is that also I'll show it on the Friday's class. That will be a continuation to this one. Even validation also, I'll check it by that time. So that is one small example here today. We had almost a lengthy session. So of course, very few students are going to be there, I think. Yeah, so almost all of them have left anyway. So that is going to be recorded. So this is how you need to go it. And there are some queries. Okay, I'll stop this one. Validation will continue that in the next week. Regarding to the queries that are raised by regarding the timing of quizzes and assignments, please let me make you sure that, see, I told you clearly, of course, we both sirs have informed you, please do not wait till the last minute. So you always need to be regular in going through the courses and performing those assessments. So always do not wait till the last minute. Of course, you are going to extend that. So we will be taking care of this. So we will extend that. Do not worry about that quizzes and the assignments. And regarding the submission, yes, that will be extended. Okay. Any other? Yeah, quiz 7. What is the question? I want to say that I have not attempted quiz 7 at time. We definitely are going to extend this thing. So there are some students who have given that one. Quiz 7. Like other quiz. Deadlines. Yes, deadlines, we keep it. Why? Because we don't want to keep it indefinite. So you always need to make sure that you are on the track. So 3-4 students are requesting for extending. Definitely, you are going to be extended. That is there. Any other doubts you have it? Those who are present, you can just pose it now. And regarding the JavaScript applications, okay, I'll continue it on the next class. Yeah, any other doubts, please? So please increase the font size. Oh, okay. So this may kindly help. ID is equal to, yes, I will try. This pass is equal to, okay, let me just try. Let me have some time here. Or let me just troubleshoot that one. Those who are having some patience, just hold on. Yeah, let me complete this.
Thank you.
Some syntax I actually have missed in that is the problem. Let statement is having some problem here. Anyway, I'll just check it out and I'll let you all know, at least for the next class. Yeah. Yeah, any other doubts, please? Yes, the dates and the times will be extended. If ID the length and pass, sir, please try this. Yeah, just let Sunny just hold on. Oh, null. Yeah. I think, yeah. Yes. This is a version's name that is a problem for me. I think the function is not the function actually. That is another.
It's property only.
It's a property only. Yeah, that's.
Sir, once try to console log the boolean value, sir. Then we may know that alert function is working or not.
The console log for this DLO is not there. That is another problem for me. I have to install another browser on this one. So I'll do that one in the next class. By the way. No, the alert function is not activating. Windows, I need to do the console because this DLO, that's what I usually prefer for Chrome only, at least because that is not done here. I'm unable to trace it out. So I'll. Okay, of course, this is not a very big thing for us. So I'll just trace it out and I'll let you know. Don't worry about that. But anyway, you have understood the process of designing your web page. Here I have not used any CSS. Please remember, you can use the CSS for your login page so that your login page looks only very crisp and neat. And you can use CSS as well as you need to understand how do you pass a values from one web page to another web page. That is the most important thing here, along with the database. So three things have been done in this discussion piece. So make sure you understand it properly and try to go on with your websites. So once you are done with this developing some websites, I will tell you how do you post it to the freely onto your internet domain. That is only the next step that we will discuss after 2-3 weeks. So that's how you need to. So that's why the first most and the foremost thing is the JavaScripts are going to be very much important for you to understand, and the PHP scripts for the server side scripting. These two things need to practice it. Practice only you need to get it. Until unless you don't do the practice, the confidence will not be developed in you. So please do practice on these things. Yeah, any other doubts, please? So almost the people have.
Sir, how exactly we should submit the assignment 3, sir, files?
You submit your along with the code, and I told you to put your logic, what you understood for the statements, right? So every statement, like here in this example, what I told you, I not kept any comments for explanation of the statements. But while you are submitting, you need to put whatever the codes you are using. something like in this suppose login.html, you need to write the comment statements. This is a form tag to hold on your these elements. This is a validation to check whether the user has entered properly the user values, username and the password. Like this, the each statement you are going to properly put comments for this, and that comments statements only you need to submit it. Along with the comment statement, you need to put the screenshot. You just take the screenshot of this one. This is login.html. Similarly, you can, once you log in, you can whether it is successful or not, you're going to go to the next file. That screenshot and this screenshot, put it together. So the put the question number followed by the code and the output. Like that, you need to put everything one by one sequentially, one after the other, in one particular file only, as the file should be in PDF file, the final file. So we will just see whether you are logically, you have been understood and you have written your code on your own. That's what your comment statements will give us, followed by whether you have done in a proper, neatly designed, and you followed the JavaScript principles and the JavaScript procedures properly with the CSS tags, whether you are using the features properly or not. Those will be available as to evaluate it. Your,
sir, so the scripts and style sheets must be in the HTML file itself, no, sir?
It can be, but it's not always preferable in the same, it need not embed in the same HTML file. Always you put it in separate folders also. You can do it. It is up to you. Whatever you, if you put it in separate folders, you put it that this is there in the folder. Under the folder, you put your file name, that's all. And you so put the code in.
Finally, we should send only HTML file with comments and some screenshots. Is it so, sir?
Yes. Every code should be there. HTML file means a code should be there. Your CSS code should be there. Your JavaScript code should be there. If you write it in separate folders, or you should include here. Just copy paste it in your Word file when you are copying the entire code. Okay. You should just give your name of the files on the top of the code as a comment statement.
No.
Are you clear with this?
Yes, sir.
So next time on the Friday session, I'll go through the VAMP along with that validation and with other student registration pages. So far, so every session, at least for half an hour or 40 minutes, I will show you some of the pages, how to design and all. So here CSS has not been shown. Let us next time when I continue this, I'll continue with CSS so that you can need not be looking like this particular page. It will be only in the middle of the page with some, like you, as you see in the Google Gmail and all. So if you do your assignment 3 properly, I'm telling you that email, use a student registration and other registration pages are there, and you're designing the page with CSS features. All that will be helpful for your designing your web pages only. So the next statement is only just to write the PHP scripts, the development of those web pages. That completes your websites. Almost, we are almost to the end of the second unit. So most probably by next week, you are starting the third unit, please. So almost 50% of the syllabus, we are very near to completion. So if you complete PHP, MySQL and all, it is almost 40 to 45% is over.